Hello all, you're watching music.com. I am Neharika Rastogi, joined by Ms. Bakhar, and we have an expert reviewer with us who will be talking about CAT Slot 1. We have IIM Bangalore alumni and a founder of GK Works, a career counseling and a mentoring institute, Vivek Gupta, sir, with us, who will be talking to us about the Slot 1 examination and the CAT aptitude test. So, sir, my first... So, sir, my first question to you is that what was the difficulty level of this time?
Okay, see, if you look at the average CAT test, which is comprised of three sections, so we will see average, which we call moderate. So, the overall CAT was moderate. It was not very tough. Now, within three sections, it is further divided. So, the first section, which is the verbal and the reasoning question, component is considered to be easy to moderate, which means people are able to score the best marks. All the analysis is showing that the highest marks somebody will get in verbal ability section out of total marks, whereas students seems to be scoring the least number of marks in the DALR section.
Okay.
And QA is in between. So if you go by that analysis, then obviously verbal becomes slightly easier. DI and LR become slightly tougher, and the quant is in between. If you compare three sections,
okay, sir.
Overall, it's an average difficulty paper, which means people are saying that out of 300 marks, somebody should be able to score about 150 marks to get IIM top IIM calls, okay, which is most important thing.
So, sir, as you're saying that it's easy to score in English, but if we are seeing by the reviews, they are saying that the English was the toughest section this time.
See, few questions or few set of reading comprehensions was difficult. Now, when I say it is easier, as I said, it is comparison between three sections.
Okay.
So, if you look at all the reviews, and I also went through some of other institutes, everybody is showing actually that somebody students are getting the highest marks in the verbal ability section. So, now what happens? Generally, people score higher in verbal ability. So, when you get a couple of tough questions, you say this entire section was tough. But for me, all the institute analyses are showing that students should be able to score highest marks in verbal ability.
Okay.
Other than couple of RC passages, the questions were pretty much straightforward.
Okay,
vis-a-vis data interpretation actually had two sets which were like impossible to solve. So if a student got stuck in one of the two sets, the CAT is gone.
Mm-hmm.
So DI has got those two sets which were like killer sets. So if any student has spent time on those sets, I think his CAT is gone.
And for the slot one, which section do you think is the toughest? Was quantitative aptitude really easy, or was it on the moderate to difficult level?
No, see, actually, as I said, quantitative aptitude was moderate. There was 8 questions which were very difficult.
Okay.
See, Niharika, we have to understand one thing, and that is what I always tell student as a CAT expert, is that nobody in the history till today has scored 300 out of 300 marks in CAT. So CAT maximum marks are 300. The highest marks are actually around 180 or 190, right?
Okay.
Which means even the best of the guy who tops the CAT exam scores only 65% marks to score 100 percentile. So you score 65% marks to get 100 percentile. You understand this thing?
Yes, sir.
Which means out of 300, student get only 180 marks and still get 100 percentile.
Okay.
Now, what are those rest 120 marks which people are not able to get?
Mm-hmm.
So, what is a typical CAT pattern? Out of, let's say, 34 quant questions, 8 were really difficult. Now, really means really difficult.
Okay.
The topper will not be solving those questions. The topper would be a smart guy who was able to leave those questions immediately,
mm-hmm,
as soon as you read that questions.
Okay.
So nobody will be able to solve those questions. So I always give a line to people who come to me for mentoring, is that it is equally important to solve questions in CAT. It is equally important to leave tough questions in CAT.
Yes, sir.
So when you are going through the CAT paper, sooner you are able to leave a tough question. So in the entire paper of about 300 questions, there would be about 18 questions which are really tough. Those questions, especially in quant, because in English it is very easy to leave verbal ability, either you know or you don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Quant, what happens, you pick up a question, you try to solve it for 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Imagine you got 60 minutes to solve 34 questions.
Okay.
Now you are stuck in 3 super tough questions. They will consume you 20 minutes. Even if you are able to solve them, there is no good thing because the marks are same. So in CAT, which is, you know, my general statement which I tell to all the students, that develop the ability to leave question also. As soon as you read a tough question, how quickly you leave it and move to the next question, which would be easy. So what the analysis are generally showing, out of 34 quant questions, 13 were very easy. And now 8 were super tough. So when you ask somebody who got stuck in those tough questions, he will say the paper was tough. As I say, I will always say, out of those 34 questions, student will get selected who was able to leave those 8 questions very quickly. He was or she was able to go through the entire paper so that you are able to see and solve the 13 easy questions.
Okay.
So Niharika, it is also a common thing that in a 3-year paper of 100 questions, most of the students are not able to even read all the questions. So that is a general trend. So the winner of the CAT would be who is able to go through all the entire paper, able to pick up easy question and solve it, and able to pick up difficult question and leave it immediately.
Okay.
So that's why I said, based on that pattern, quant was moderate because you were supposed to leave those difficult questions very easily, very quickly.
Okay, sir.
And DI, which was the third section, is actually two sets were, as I said, out of 32 questions, 8 questions or 2 sets were really difficult. So if a student started solving those sets, a set in a DI always have 4 questions. So you generally tend to spend 4 to 5 minutes beforehand, you come to know that it's tough. So now imagine you have spent 10 minutes and then you realize it's a tough set. I am not going anywhere, I am not able to solve anything. And you give further more 5 minutes, then you give further more 3 minutes. So you see that you spent 18 minutes and you are standing at zero.
Yeah.
Once again, Niharika, student who are able to leave those sets quickly would be the winner. So in DI, what people are saying to crack 99th percentile in each section, roughly if I broadly tell you, everybody's students are giving me the feedback that in verbal, you can actually score 70 marks out of 100, whereas quant, you can score about 57 to 60, whereas DI, you should be happy to score 50.
Okay.
So for a topper, the topper is going to score about 170 marks, it would be like 70 in verbal, about 58 in quant and 52 in DI. That's why I said, looking at the pattern of the marks, that verbal is technically easy to moderate, means people are able to score 70 marks out of 100. DI is toughest because toppers will be struggling to cross 50 out of 100 marks. The guy who scored highest marks in DI, LR section, would be scoring only 52, 54 marks out of 100. Whereas quant would be around 60. So that's why, that is how I will say which section is tough, which section is easy.
Okay, sir. So, sir, my other question to you is that if he is saying that the CAT paper was moderate, so how has the percentile system been decided for a student?
See, Niharika, this is a very good question, definitely. And you know, this again, one thing which I tell everybody, in a competitive world, it doesn't matter that the paper is easy, moderate or difficult, because it is not any absolute mark that you are fighting for. Let's say the paper is super easy. Super means super duper easy. Everybody will score high marks, correct? So out of the maximum marks of 300, let's say student will score 240, highest marks. Whereas if the paper is super tough, highest marks would be 130 out of 300, which had been the case for a couple of years in CAT. Now the percentile system works in such a manner that I will give 100 percentile to the student who scored highest marks, whether it is 130 or whether it is 270. So, in a percentile system, it doesn't matter whether the paper was overall easy or difficult, because I will choose the top 12,000 students out of 240,000 students to offer interview slots and personal interview and GDPI slots.
Okay, sir.
So, now that the paper was tough, everybody has low marks. when paper is easy, everybody has higher marks. But now there is a twist. And now that is a twist, which is, as I said, it's a very unique thing. See, when the verbal paper is easier, engineers have an advantage. So what happens in India, Niharika, it's a very interesting thing. And when I was in IIM Bangalore, out of a batch of 200 students, 170 were engineers with a B.Tech background. Okay? Now, the entire IIM fraternity, they always want more non-engineers to come in IIMs. But what happens, a typical engineer generally would be very strong in quant. He would be very strong in data interpretation, logical reasoning, and generally not very strong in verbal ability. Whereas the non-B.Tech students would be reversed. So they are very strong in verbal and they are not very strong in quant and DI. So now, how does it place? When the verbal becomes tough, the non-B.Tech guys will still solve the questions because he is very strong in that paper. Whereas B.Tech would be really struggling, really struggling. So their marks will get low. And in the overall percentile, we will have more non-engineers reaching the IIMs. Whereas when the verbal is easy, like this time, engineers will also have easier way to solve it. And DI is very difficult. So maybe the non-engineering background or the non-science background student will find it tough. So in summary, if this is the CAT paper, then the verbal is easier. You will again see more B.Tech students reaching IIMs than non-B.Tech or should I say non-science.
Okay, sir.
So that is how interpretation I can tell you, looking at the sectional easiness. That this is how it actually impacts. So when the paper is easy, the paper is difficult, we just discussed. But section wise, if verbal becomes easy, it is good for engineers who are generally struggling in that part. Whereas when the quant becomes tough, So that is how the logic happens. So because this time the verbal is easy, which means engineers will be able to solve verbal questions. DI was really tough. So non-engineering background students, non-science background students will find it more difficult to solve those questions. And when the overall percentage score will come, we might see. So that is how I can, you know, visualize that after 3 months or 4 months, we will again see more B.Tech and more science students reaching IIMs than non-B.Tech.
Okay. So, as you are an IIM Bangalore alumni, which college do you think is the best for any MBA aspirant?
See, very frankly, so there are three categories of B schools in India, which I always say. So one is the B schools in which the IIMs fall. And if you talk about the best college, there is always a fight between IIM Ahmedabad, Bangalore and Calcutta, which is the best. Being IIM Bangalore guy, I will say IIM Bangalore is the best. But how I will tell students, go for IIMs, then institute like FMS, Narsimhanji, Mumbai, XLRI, these are the institute with the tier 1 institute, SP Jain, MDA Gurgaon, IMD Ghaziabad, they fall into that bracket. So every student should really aspire to reach there. Then there is a next level of institute which I call tier 2 institutes. So in which Narsimhanji, Hyderabad and Bangalore campus can come, IMD, Nagpur campus can come, and these kind of institutes come, which is tier 2. And then there is tier 3. Generally, I advise students not to go to tier 3 because there is hardly any learning in those big colleges. So it is better to maybe change your course and do some other course. And especially for the tier 3 and the tier 2 students also, I always advise that there are better institutes that you can get if you go abroad.
Okay.
So rather than going for a tier 3 college in India, it is always good to go for a top university in, let's say, UK or Australia or USA for that matter, because with same amount of money, you will get far better education.
Yes.
So if you reach, in terms of ranking, if you are able to crack any college within top 70 rank of India, and that ranking should be genuine, that ranking should not be, you know, biased.
Yes, sir.
Then go for those colleges. Otherwise, I'm not very supportive of somebody joining a very tier 3 college in a small city of India and not learning anything and wasting 2 years and money. So it is better to go abroad and study in top universities there.
So my colleague has a question. So if IIM Ahmedabad had the highest cutoff, we talk about IIM Lucknow, IIM Bangalore, Calcutta. So why is it that Ahmedabad gets more high cutoff?
Better students.
Yeah.
See, very frankly, Harika, once again, question which is basic of education. So see what happens, students go for perception. Okay. So now till today, till last year, IIM Ahmedabad students get the best placements. Now, IIM Ahmedabad gets the best placement because IIM Ahmedabad gets the best students. Okay, so it's a vicious cycle. Every year, IIM Ahmedabad gets the best students. They go in the industry and do a good job, a good work. So it further enhances the name of IIM Ahmedabad, and that's why students always choose IIM Ahmedabad for the next year also.
Okay,
so I would say the faculty of the teaching of IIM Bangalore or Calcutta is as good as IIM Ahmedabad. But it is just because of the perception which is happening, and because last year all the toppers went to IIM Ahmedabad, so this year also all the toppers will go to IIM Ahmedabad.
Yes, sir.
So it happens. It's a herd mentality, very frankly.
Okay, sir. Sir, which institute do you think is the best for students who are planning to go for MBA and are planning to apply for CAT next year?
See, that is what I just mentioned for next year. For coaching institute.
See, sir.
Once again, Niharika, very, very interesting question, and I have very different perspective. So see, as we just mentioned, IIM Ahmedabad, Bangalore, they are the places, and the brand name stays with you for life. For example, I am IIM Bangalore alumni, you know, it's with me for my entire life. So as I said, somebody, you want to go to IIM, let's say Indore, because you believe that IIM Indore might give you good education, and it is a great place anyway, but still you will go for IIM Ahmedabad because Ahmedabad has a very different brand name. See, that is not the case with the coaching institute. You will not tell in future, you know, I have taken the coaching from X institute or Y institute, so that's what is the best institute, right? So when it comes to coaching, I have a very simple philosophy, which I again tell to all the people who come to me for personal mentoring. Simple education is about three things: student, teacher, and a nice classroom, isn't it? The brand name doesn't make a difference.
Yes, sir.
So it actually doesn't matter that whether you take a coaching with, let's say if I take five names of India which are top: Time, Career Launcher, IMS, you know, PT Education, Endeavor, or Byju's. For me, I always say go to a institute branch, meet the faculty that is going to teach you, and understand whether you will be able to have a connection with them. So without taking an institute name, I can tell you, let's say there is an X institute. That institute branch in Pitampura, where I live, might be very good because they have a great teacher who is delivering the class. Same institute name will have a very average performance in some other center because the faculty there is average.
Okay.
So there is no standard answer that whether the X institute is better, Y or is Z. It is always the faculty which is the best.
Okay.
So what students should always take care is which teacher is going to teach me. So when you go to an institute, please ask which teacher is going to teach me. If they allow, sit in two or three demo class of that teacher. Or ask your senior students that who was the teacher who taught you the best, and then join the batch or the class of that teacher.
Okay.
So the brand name of institute doesn't matter in any coaching, in my opinion. It is a teacher who is going to teach you. As I said, there are three things, four things, very frankly. Fourth is material. So Niharika, material is available everywhere, right? You can actually buy the material from the market of any institute. A AC classroom can be made by anybody. But what makes the difference is the person who is going to finally and actually teach. So I always tell all the students, whether it is CAT coaching, whether 5 years back it was IIT coaching or medical coaching, any coaching of life, always meet the teacher who is going to teach you and see that whether you are able to get right education from that teacher.
Yes, sir.
The brand name of institute doesn't matter at all, in my opinion. So student has to do that hard work. Go for the branch. So do this kind of research. Ask your senior in your school, college, and find out the teacher who is a very good teacher and join the batch of that particular teacher. That is the right answer of your question.
Okay, sir. So my colleague has a question for you.
Yes.
Hello, Vivek, sir. I am
Ms. Hi.
Okay, so I want to ask you about slot 2. So what are your expectations from the slot 2? Have you got any reviews from your students or, you know?
Not now, because I'm talking to you right now, very frankly, okay? So I'm not able to particularly get a difference of slot 2. See, my experience of life has been, generally, IIMs doesn't differentiate between slot 1 and slot 2.
Okay.
They will go with a set pattern. Because otherwise the slot 2 people can, you know, give a bad feedback that why in our batch this session become tough or this session become easier. So if you look at the last 10 years pattern, a standard answer would be that the slot 1 analysis and slot 2 analysis would mostly be same.
Okay.
But having said that, you know, 5:30 the slot 2 actually ended.
Yeah.
So students were just about to talk to me.
Okay.
So hopefully by 8 p.m. I shall be able to tell you about slot 2 if there is any difference.
Okay,
broadly, I can tell you, IIM authority doesn't make this difference too much. So they will keep the pattern same.
So last year, Niharika gave CAT exam, and according to her, slot 2 was difficult as compared to slot 1. So is there a difference between slot 2 and slot 1?
So that's a set, so you have to just call me back again after 1 hour because I still have to get feedback from the students. Okay.
Okay, so
I'm expecting. Yeah, I'm expecting around 7 o'clock.
Okay, so one last question. What is the minimum percentile a student can get to get into MBA, into a good college?
See, that's the right question. In MBA, you can get even at 40 percentile. Okay, that is the sad part which is happening in India right now. But to go to a good college, a top 70 college, which I just said, you should be above 90 percentile minimum. And then if you are over 95, you can expect IIM calls, which is actually the thing which students should try. But minimum 90 percentile to get a decent good college.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you so much for sharing your views and having the expert with us. And I'm sure the candidates are also feeling welcomed and understanding what the CAT is all about. Thank you so much for joining us, sir.
My pleasure. Take care. Have a nice evening.
Bye-bye. Thank you, sir.
Bye, sir. For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.